patrollers and candidates. My name is Cameron, and the purpose of this video is to go over some knots and hitches that will be useful to you when you are out patrolling. So let's get started. To start off, I want to define some terms. So a knot technically is, you know, a way in which you assemble the rope so that it only requires the rope to maintain its strength and shape. So this is a knot. It's an overhand on a bite. Whereas a hitch is a type of knot that requires another object, usually that the rope is passing around, to maintain its integrity, such as the clove hitch. So that's the difference between a knot and a hitch. You'll also hear the term bend. That's typically used to describe when you're connecting two ends together. Say, joining two ends of rope together, two ends of webbing together. That can be called a bend. Similarly, you'll hear the terms loop and bite. A loop is when you create a circle with the rope by crossing the rope over itself. Whereas a bite, you create a circle simply by bringing the rope and pinching it alongside itself. So a bite and a loop. For a bite, you can think of something like biting down on the rope side by side. Pretty simple stuff, but that'll make understanding the rest of this video a little easier. The first knot I want to go over is called the overhand knot. And it's pretty much the simplest knot you can tie out there. So you make a bite. With the tail, you want to wrap around kind of the stationary side of the rope and just poke through the backside. Get a nice little overhand. If you just need a simple, straightforward stopper knot in the end of a rope, this will do that. You can also tie a overhand loop. So you need a bigger bite of rope. Grab these two strands and treat them as one rope and do the same thing. So with that, with those two strands, make a bite, wrap around the backside, and pull through, and you get an overhand on a bite. And this is a nice strong loop. If you just need to clip something to the rope very conveniently and quickly. This, you know, technically is strong enough to hold like the load of a patient, but there are stronger knots that you'll see later in this video that I would choose over this for, you know, lowering someone or hauling someone, creating anchors. Another quick way to tie this, let's say you don't have the end of the rope, you're just working with the middle of the rope. Take a bite and I should explain, this is a nice way to get two loops for anchoring or clipping into. Instead of taking the end of that bite and poking it through, you're gonna take two of those strands that are closer to the knot and just start to poke those through. And then take that loop that's still left over at the end and push that over everything. And then go back to those two loops that you had partially pushed through and pull on those to tighten it up, you can get two loops. It's really just an overhand. So you could call that like a double overhand on a bite. Untie it just by doing the exact opposite. And if you pop it free, you can come back to a normal overhand on a bite. Let's say you are working with the end of the rope and you have an object that you need to tie around, but it's not something that can be opened up like a carabiner. Let's say you want to make an anchor around a tree, something like that. Give yourself plenty of rope to wrap around what you actually need to, plus an extra foot or two, and go back and tie that very simple overhand. Take your tail, pass it through or around whatever you need to, and then with your tail, you're going to follow this strand of rope back through that initial knot that we tied. You could call that an overhand follow through or an overhand rethread. And really you're just recreating that initial overhand on a bite that we tied earlier. It's just a different way to tie it. Next we have the figure eight. And it's very similar to the overhand. Start off with a bite. Take the tail and wrap over, you know, the stationary end of the rope or the standing end of the rope, you might hear. And instead of poking through from the back like we did with the overhand, we're going to keep coming all the way around to the front and poke through from the front. That should give you something that resembles a figure eight. And that's where the name comes from. So just like with the overhand, we can pretty much do all those types of variations with the figure eight. So if you take a big enough bite of rope, you can treat those two strands as a single strand and do a figure eight on a bite. And you'll probably see this way more common than the overhand. This is a lot stronger. It's a lot less likely to come undone. I would definitely trust this with a patient load, or if I'm lowering a patroller down to someone, or lowering a toboggan, or attaching a rope to a patient to create a pulley system and haul them up. Definitely trust this over the overhand. Again, if you need to tie around a tree to create an anchor, or you know, through some sort of anchor point, give yourself enough tail, and then tie that simple figure eight. Run your tail through whatever you need to wrap it through, and follow this strand back through that knot like we did with the overhand. You'll get your figure eight follow through or figure eight rethread. And just like the overhand, it's the same, ends up being the same knot as a figure eight on a bite. So just a different way to achieve that loop. Again, similarly like the, you know, double overhand on a bite that we tied earlier, you can do that with the figure eight. So, you know, again, you won't be working with the end of the rope, but you'll have a bite you can make out of the middle of the rope. And start off by essentially tying a big overhand on a bite or sorry, figure eight on a bite, not overhand. And instead of finishing it by pushing the end of the loop through, take some of the rope closer to the knot and start to push it through the top. And then take that end of the loop and bring it over everything, tighten it up, and you get a double figure eight on a bite. A lot of times I think you'll hear people call these bunny ears. So this is great for clipping the two anchors. Another variation is a three looped way to do this. And you can do this with the overhand too if you want. I didn't show you guys. So you kind of just go back one step from the double loop. You know, we had the end of the loop that was pulled over everything and then it was tightened. Well, if you undo that last step, so you're back to having that end loop, simply take that loop and wrap it around the main part of rope and then push it through the last step of the knot where your other two loops are already poking out through. And you can just do a little adjusting to get them all be the same length if you need them to be the same length. Or you can play around with it and get them to all be different lengths if one anchor is further away than the other. And that's a three loop figure eight. And again, you can do that with the overhand as well if you want to do that. One other variation I'll show you guys is, let's say you do want to tie a loop in the middle of the rope. You know, you can obviously do that with a figure eight on a bite like we did earlier. But let's say the rope is going to be pulled apart like this. I can't do it with my own strength, but if there's enough force pulling apart like this, that can actually make the figure eight knot roll over itself to the point where it'll actually roll right off the end of its loop and come undone. So to avoid something like that, and especially if we just need to hold a load that's coming from one direction, you can tie a directional figure eight. So let's say the load we want to hold is over here. So the direction of force will be pulling this way. With the hand that's towards that load, I'm going to create a loop by bringing that hand and that strand over away from the load. So we just created a loop. Now we're going to pass that loop under the strand that's furthest away from the load. So we're simply just gonna slide it under that. Then we're going to wrap it up and over and pass it through this loop where the strand that's going towards the load is popping out of. So it looks something like that. And really, if you take a look at it, it just looks like a figure eight knot that's been partially untied. But that is a convenient way to hold a load that's pulling in a certain direction and you only have the middle of the line to work with. And you'll know you've tied it correctly because the end of the rope that's heading towards the load will be exiting out of the same loop that the actual figure eight loop is popping out of. If you tie it incorrectly, I don't know why, but it's always kind of weird trying to tie a knot incorrectly. See how this strand pops out on the different side of this strand than from the loop? You don't want that. You want to make sure you do a full wrap. and have them pop out
all together.
And one last thing that I didn't show you yet was how do you double check just a regular figure eight on a bite? Which is you should have five pairs of rope. So a pair down here, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 2, 4, 6, 8, 10. And you'll be able to see that no matter what side of the knot you're looking at. The figure eight, whether you're doing a figure eight on a bite or a figure eight follow through, is such a strong and secure knot that it typically doesn't necessarily require having a backup. But I'll show you how to tie two different backups just in case you feel like you want them or need them. So I'm just gonna tie another figure eight on a bite really quick. I think I actually got a little wonky. There we go. And I intentionally left myself plenty of tail. And you'll see in the video how to tie a double fisherman's knot. I do that by placing my thumb on the main line of rope coming out of the figure eight. And with the tail, wrap once around the thumb. A second time, that crosses over the first wrap, so it creates an X on my thumb. And then bring the tail up from below and replace it, or replace my thumb with it. And that creates a double fisherman's knot. And the way that that backs up the figure eight is if for some reason the figure eight maybe gets damaged or comes undone, this double fisherman's will cinch up against the knot so that it can't actually pull the tail all the way through. But it's very unlikely that the figure eight will fail in any way unless it's purely due from overloading stress or it gets like cut by a rock or something. Another way to back up the figure eight is called the Yosemite finish for a figure eight. And really what that means is you take the tail, the tip of the tail, and we're going to place it back into the knot so that it immediately can then exit the knot in the same way that this loop exits the knot. So we can go around back behind the main line one more time if you want, and then just pop it in to this final, or under these final two strands. So it literally exits alongside our main loop. And that's called the Yosemite finish. And what I like to do with that, like if I'm using this to climb on, which if, when I climb with a figure eight, I typically use the Yosemite backup. I actually leave this part up here a little loose, kind of as like a little handle, so that when I'm done with the figure eight, I can very easily pull this tail out. And no matter how tight this got, by being able to pull that tail out, it automatically leaves a little gap in the knot and makes it easy to untie the rest of it. So it can still be hard to untie a figure eight sometimes, but that will help. Another way to create a strong, convenient loop is with the bowline knot, or the bowline knot. And to do that, get some rope over here. So, and the nice thing about this is I can either just tie this right away to create a loop in the rope, or I can use this to tie it around an object like a tree or a pole and it doesn't really change how I tie this. So I start off with the tail side of the rope, up past that side of the rope, away from the tail to create a loop. And now we'll call the tail the snake, and the tip of the tail is actually the head of the snake. This loop we made is called the hole, and the rest of the rope is the tree. So the snake's head comes up from below the hole, pops up, and then from right to left, we go behind the tree. Come back to the front, and he pops his head back into the hole. And then we pinch his head against the rest of his body, and we grab the tree, and we pull our hands apart. And that will tighten up, and that is your bowline. And you'll know you've tied it correctly when the tail, or rather the head of the snake, pops out inside of this loop. If you tie it incorrectly, whereas, you know, earlier when we popped the snake's head out of the hole, we went from right to left behind the tree, which is very important. If you forget that or mess it up and you go from left to right around the tree and then back into the hole, you'll see that the snake's head pops out and it's outside of this loop, whereas earlier it was inside it. You do not want to tie this. This is dangerous. It's definitely not as secure as the proper bowline. So make sure you're tying that bowline correctly. If you are tying it like around a tree or through a fixed loop, what you do is you'll make that first loop you made, pass the tail around whatever point you have to get it through or around, and then you'll finish off the bowline. And that's how you can tie that around a tree or something like that. Now this bowline is strong, but it's not quite as secure as say a figure eight on a bite or a figure eight follow through. But there's a way to make it more secure. And so to do that, we'll start off our bowline just like normal, make that loop. But we're gonna add another step, which is we'll make a second identical loop and just place it, sit right on top of that first loop. Then, you know, we can pass the tail through whatever object, or if we're just making a standalone loop, tie the bowline like normal from this point. Again, making sure we go from right to left behind the tree. And then you can start to tighten stuff up, and it'll be a little trickier to tighten up just because you have two loops here now instead of one. But before you completely tighten it up, we're gonna take that tail and we're gonna bring it backwards or below the knot, bring it out to our right and back to the front. So it's kind of starting to match these two wraps. And if you look at this lower wrap and follow it around to the left, you'll see that it actually becomes the main line of rope. Well, with our tail, or the snake's head, if you still want to call it that, we're going to follow that wrap through the remainder of the knot. So it pops out alongside the main line of rope. Now you can tighten stuff up, pull on every strand individually. And you want to make sure you at least have, you know, a good 5 to 6 inches of tail, just be safe. But that last final step we did, you'd call that a Yosemite finish, like Yosemite National Park. So it's a bowline with a Yosemite finish, but then we had that extra loop that we made at the start just for a little extra security as well. And this is a very strong, very stable loop. People who are rock climbers who climb with a bowline instead of a figure eight follow through, they'll typically actually tie this. So I trust this with a patient load. I trust this, you know, hauling a toboggan with a pulley system or lowering a toboggan. Anything you would trust a figure eight follow through or a figure eight on a bite, I would trust this variation of the bowline. And again, it's really easy to untie, just like the standard bowline. Let's say you want to be able to tie a bowline, especially a double bowline, but you only have the middle of the rope to work with, you can do that. And essentially, we're going to start off by tying an overhand on a bite. So get a nice big bite. Start off tying your overhand on a bite. And you'll start to poke that tip of the bite through. But before you pull it through completely, if you follow that top of the loop back through the knot, these two loops are what are going to become the double part of the bowline. So you take this head of the loop and pass it over everything else. Pull on those two loops that I pointed out, and you'll see it resembles a bowline. There's just two loops and also two wraps, like that variation I showed you before this one. You can untie that just by peeling that same upper loop away to loosen it up and just undo the overhand on a bite. Let's say you want a double bowline and you are working with the end of the rope. So let's say you want to create a double bowline around a fixed anchor like a tree or a metal pole, you can do this. So give yourself plenty of tail, like enough to wrap around that object, say like 2.5 times, plus a little extra. And start off by tying just a normal bowline. You'll just have a very long tail, which is what you want. Make sure that tail pops out kind of behind that loop, but it's still in the middle like we want it to be. Just like that Yosemite finish, we're gonna start following something, but instead of following this loop right here, see how the tail exits out alongside one part or side of this loop? Well, we're going to keep following that loop with the remainder of the tail and essentially kind of re-tie the rest of the knot. And this is the point where if we had tied that first loop around like a tree, you'd pass the tail around that same anchor point or tree again. So just remember to do that part. And you'll finish the knot by tying a Yosemite finish, like I showed you a little bit ago. And now we can have a double bowline around a fixed object. And I'll remove this carabiner just to show you guys. This is actually the same double bowline that I showed you that was kind of similar to the overhand on a bite. If I pull that tip of the loop and undo it, we get back to where we were with that other hitch. So same knot, just different way to tie it. Another knot that's good for making a loop, especially if you only have the middle of the rope to work with, is called the Alpine Butterfly. There's actually two ways to tie this. First off, probably the simplest, easiest way to do it is to get a bite, flip it once to kind of make an X, flip it again in the same direction so that you kind of actually end up with two loops. And you want to maintain both of these intersections, like keep those intact while we do this, but you're going to take the tip of the outer loop and you're going to pass it underneath everything to the other side of the main line, bring it up and over and poke it through those two loops. Tighten everything up. And that is an Alpine Butterfly. And this is great because this loop is super strong in every direction. It's kind of like that directional figure eight I showed you earlier, except this will hold load in any direction. And like the Bowline, it's really easy to untie. You just take either of these loops at the end on the backside and peel them down towards the rest of the rope. So you can do that on either end of it. Really great. Not only does this make a good like anchor loop or attachment point, but this is also a great way and pretty much kind of the standard way to isolate a damaged section of rope. Say there was some rock fall and a sharp rock like pierced through the sheath, but the rest of the rope is fine. Just tie a quick Alpine Butterfly so that the damaged portion of the rope ends up at least somewhere in this loop, and you can continue using the rest of the loop. Just make sure that if you're lowering someone or you're, you know, doing a haul system, that you know how to pass a knot with whatever system you're using, but it's a nice way to do that. If you don't like that method of tying the knot, there's another method. So lay out your hand, let me get rid of that, and make a wrap around your hand, and then make another wrap in the same direction. So you end up with three strands kind of laying across your hand. Now that first wrap that you made, or that first strand rather, that's on your hand closest to your thumb, pick it up and just pull it across the rest of those strands. So really that turns that strand into the new third strand. We have a new first strand, new second strand. Take your new first strand, and this is actually what's going to become the loop itself. Pass it over those other two strands, tuck it underneath those two, and bring it back towards where we started. Pull that out a little bit, and then pull these two tails apart. And it'll flip a bit of the knot, but you'll see it turns into that same Alpine Butterfly. And if we want, we can even untie it as the reverse of the first way that we tied it, so you can literally see it's still the same knot, just a different variation. It's nice to know that second way to tie the knot though, because you use that method to be able to tie, say, a double loop or triple loop version of the Alpine Butterfly. So say we're tying a double loop, we'll make wraps around our hand and keep these wraps a little bit looser. You know, they're not tight around the back. So now I need to give myself a little bit more rope. So for the single loop Alpine Butterfly, we made we made two wraps around to get three strands. Well, for a two loop Alpine Butterfly, you need to do an additional wrap to get four strands. And just like with the single loop Alpine Butterfly, we're gonna take this strand number one closest to our thumb, pull it across all the other loops. So now we have our new strand number one, strand number two, three, four. Simultaneously, we're going to grab new strands one and two. And these two strands are going to be the two loops within the double Alpine Butterfly. We're going to bring these across towards our fingertips, tuck them under the other strands, and then pull those back. Again, you're going to pull on the tails and it'll shift the knot a little bit. But once it's done shifting, you can tidy it up and you get a double Alpine Butterfly. And you can keep following that same logic if for some reason you feel like you need or want more loops. So, you know, if we want to tie a triple looped Alpine Butterfly, you get five strands, pass the first strand across, then grab the first three strands simultaneously, pass them across underneath. And so every time you want to add a loop, you're going to have to make those wraps around your hand bigger and bigger. But that's how you go about that. A very useful hitch, and really the first hitch I'm showing you, is called the Clove Hitch. And if you've already spent a fair amount of time placing out sticks of bamboo and tying rope or a twine to them, you've probably already learned this. But it's pretty straightforward. You just make a loop. You can either do it from right to left or left to right. However you made that first loop, you're going to make an identical one and pass the second loop you made behind the first loop. And then you can either place that over the top of a stick of bamboo, you can clip a carabiner into there, and pull on each strand to snug it up. And if you tie it correctly, you should have each tail strand and like a diagonal in between them. The other side is just like a pair of rope. It's a very simple hitch, but this can actually, if it's a flexible enough rope that can cinch up tightly on a carabiner or whatever else it's through, it can actually hold body weight. Say in single strand rappelling, where you use a carabiner block to hold the rappel rope at the anchor, this will hold a rappeller's weight. So it can be a very strong hitch. Just have to make sure it's dressed nice and cleanly and pre-tightened. But it's nice because if it's tied around a carabiner and it's super tight, you can just open up the carabiner and kind of slide it out of it. So this is a great hitch because you can either tie it from the middle of the rope, or if you have the end of the rope, you can essentially build it like on a carabiner or around a pole. You kind of wrap it around, bring the tail to one side, either the right or left, pass it back around through the object and around itself. Let me get that out of the way. So that it crosses over the original strand. Then tighten that up like usual. There you go. And this can be a little tricky to tie if you have like a thicker static rope that doesn't like to bend easily. It's not very flexible. But this is a very useful hitch. Another very versatile knot is called the double fisherman's knot. And very basic way to tie it is to, you know, I kind of grab the main line of rope with my thumb laying across it. And with enough tail, can make a wrap around your thumb, make a second wrap, so that actually kind of creates an X on your thumb. And then from the bottom of your thumb going up, you're going to replace your thumb with that tip of the rope under that X. And it creates an X on one side, that same X that was over our thumb. The other side is a pair of rope. So this is a great stopper knot. This is the stopper knot you probably see most people use when they're rappelling. You'll put this at the end of the rope. Keeps you from rappelling off the end of your rope if it's too short to reach the ground. Similarly, you can tie a triple fisherman's knot. So instead of just two wraps around our thumb, you do three wraps. So creates an X plus another strand. And that's what a triple fisherman's looks like. So this is great for a stopper knot. You can also use this as like an anchor knot. Let's say we pass a rope through a fixed ring of metal or something. Orient this so you guys can kind of see better. Now, instead of placing our thumb like on the tail, we'll place it on the main line of rope coming away from the anchor and do the same thing. Tie a wrap and then a second wrap to create the X around our thumb. That double fisherman's, actually if we pull it, it slides and it'll cinch up against the anchor. And this is nice because it allows you to tie a very strong, you know, this can be weight bearing, body weight wise. You can tie a very strong anchor if you don't have much rope to work with. And to untie it, if you are using a carabiner, you can simply unclip the carabiner and remove it. But know that this will cinch up really tight. So if you don't have it around something that's openable, like a carabiner, it can sometimes feel like it's impossible to untie this. When it's tied like this, like a double fisherman's knot, it's typically called a poacher's knot. If you give it that extra wrap, so it's three wraps, you get more rope. So you got one, two, and three. And just like that triple fisherman's, only it's through an anchor now. That's typically called a scaffold knot. And, you know, you might ask, okay, when would you use a double fisherman's versus a triple fisherman's? If I'm truly using this to hold a patient, or if I'm working with thinner or less flexible rope, I'll use the triple, or in this case, the scaffold knot. But if I'm doing something less important, just something quicker, I'll do the double fisherman or the poacher's knot. Now that was just for, you know, creating a stopper knot or creating an anchor knot. You can also use the double fishermans to attach two different ropes together. And how you do that is, you know, you take your first rope and do double fishermans around your other rope. Flip things around and then tie the same exact double fishermans with the tail of the other rope. When you pull on these, the two double fishermans will cinch up against each other, and that's a very strong rope connection. And again, this will get very tight and can sometimes be impossible to untie. So just know that. So you can either do this the double fisherman style or the triple fisherman style if you're working with a thinner rope or you think you need more strength. Another knot or bend you can use to tie two ends of rope together is called the Flemish Bend, which really is just a figure eight follow through, but you're using two ropes. So I'm tying just my normal figure eight in one of those ropes, and then I'm going to do the follow through part from end to end, following this strand of rope all the way through that figure eight with the tail of the other rope. And that's a nice strong way to attach two ropes to each other. And this is very strong. You can hold a patient load with this. It's just like using the triple fisherman's to join two ends of rope together. Except this will probably be easier to untie when you're done. When working with tubular webbing, if you need to join two ends together, whether to create a closed loop or you're joining two separate lengths of webbing together, there's pretty much only one standard knot or bend for that, and you'd call that the water knot or the tape knot. And just like how the Flemish bend, it joins two ends of rope and really it's like the figure eight follow through, the water knot will join webbing together just like an overhand follow through. So you take one end of your webbing, simply tie an overhand, just the very basic overhand. Make sure you're leaving at least, you know, 5 to 6 inches of tail. And with your other end of webbing, you're simply following through and re-threading that initial overhand knot. Again, making sure you pull enough through so that you have 5 to 6 inches of tail. Kind of turns out looking almost like a little folded American flag, if you think about it. A little triangle. And if you plan on leaving this in place for a while, like you're tying a length of webbing together to be a hasty harness or something like that, with these tails, go ahead and tie either one overhand on each tail around the main strand of webbing. Or if you have enough, or you give yourself enough tail on either side of the knot, you can tie a double fisherman's in each tail, and that'll be even more secure. Now I'll talk about friction hitches, which are a special type of hitch that lets you grab onto a rope and either pull it or keep it stationary, depending on what you're trying to accomplish. And the first of those hitches I'm going to show you is called a Prusik or a Prusik, depending on who you talk to. And to start off, it's really just like a girth hitch. Technically, you could call this a single wrapped Prusik. But if you wrap around again and poke it through that same loop, that's a double wrapped Prusik. And typically for like rescue loads, stuff we'll be doing with ski patrol, like haul systems, you'll want a triple wrapped Prusik. So just tighten that up, get all the slack out. And the nice thing about the Prusik is that it holds in either direction. So no matter what you pull it, it should grip the rope. In order to move it along the rope, you have to press on it from the opposite side that you want to move it towards. And it'll be able to grip back up immediately again. Sometimes after these have held an extreme load, they can be pretty hard to break loose and move again. So if you take this kind of strand of rope that's crossing over all the individual wraps, you can peel it away from those wraps and that'll help loosen it up pretty easily. So this is a very common friction hitch to see. A lot of people will use this as a third hand or backup for their rappel, but because it grips so well, you'd want to make sure you use it on the brake strand below your blade of ice, not above it. Because if your full body weight hangs on this and you try to release it, odds are you probably won't be able to, or if you can, it'll be very difficult. It grips the rope that well. One thing to keep in mind is that typically for friction hitches like this, the diameter of the cord that you're using as your friction hitch will typically need to be smaller than the diameter of rope that you're wrapping it around. So before you go to use a friction hitch out in the real world, make sure you play around with the type of gear that you plan on using, practice with it, and know the limits of what diameters of rope it can work with. And another common application you'll see for the Prusik is in pulley systems, as what's called a progress catch. So right here, we have the top of what could be a typical pulley system. Got a pulley and a short triple wrap Prusik in front of it. So now, and this is a special pulley, it's called a Prusik mining pulley, or PMP. So as I'm pulling up my load, the Prusik gets bunched up against the bottom of the pulley, which releases it and allows the rope to go through. But then when I need to reset the pulley or stop for whatever reason, give it some slack and the Prusik will grab on the rope immediately and keep that progress that I pulled up for me. So this is a pretty common application for a Prusik. You can also use a Prusik to ascend a rope or descend it. Say you have someone who is rappelling on a line and they get jammed up down below, like their hair got caught on their blade of ice or something. Well, now they're stranded on a taut line of rope, and for most blade devices or descent devices, you won't be able to clip them onto a tight rope and descend. So if you have two Prusiks or a Prusik and another type of friction hitch, you can descend on a line, kind of inchworm your way down, using the opposite technique that you'd use to ascend the line. So keep that in mind. Another common friction hitch you'll see is called an Autoblock, and it's also known as the French Prusik. And this is probably the most common friction hitch you'll see for using as a third hand for rappelling. And it's a very simple friction hitch to tie. And for the Autoblock, I'll be demonstrating this with a special product. It's called the Hollow Block by Sterling. It's specifically designed to be used as a friction hitch. It's actually hollow on the inside, which lets it flatten out and create a larger surface area to contact the main rope. And the material it's made out of has a very high melting point, because friction hitches, when they're sliding along a rope, that will generate a lot of heat. So this is designed not to melt like a typical cord can melt. And so to tie the Autoblock, keep the stitched part out of the way, and you literally just spiral wrap the whole thing down. You could use normal cord for this too. Like for the Prusik, that was a 7mm cord. You can use 6mm. You can even use 5mm depending on how much weight you need it to hold. So after you do that spiral wrap, you just clip those two ends of the loop together and it will hold. And just like the Prusik, it will hold in either direction, but it won't grip the rope quite as strongly as a Prusik will, but it releases easier. So most of the time it is still nice to use the Autoblock if you're using it as a third hand, to use it below your blade device on the brake strand. But you will still see people use this up above their blade device, just because it is easier to release it when your full weight is hanging on it. It still might be a little difficult depending on how many wraps you have, the diameter of the cord, and what kind of material you're using for your Autoblock. So again, just play around with that before you actually go to rely on it in the real world. So yeah, pretty convenient. Another friction hitch you can tie is called the Bachmann hitch. And it's similar to the Autoblock, except it incorporates a carabiner that can make it a little easier to move along the rope. And this makes it great for using it to ascend the line or descend the line. If you need to, say, get up to a chair to help evacuate a patient, or if you need to descend a rope that is too tight to put a descent device on. So as you do, you take your carabiner, and you can tie this either with cord or sling. I like to use sling because I, for the most part, think it creates a more predictable grip, especially if you're moving the friction hitch around on the rope a lot. So you clip the sling or your loop of cord into the carabiner. make sure the stitched or tied portion is near the end, but not at the very end. Have it offset slightly. Position that sling or cord at the top of the carabiner, rest it along the rope, and spiral wrap downward around both the rope and the spine of the carabiner. And do that until you either run out of room or think you have enough friction for what you need to accomplish. And after that last wrap, just let your sling or cord dangle out of the bottom of the carabiner. And so what's important to understand is that you'll want your load, whether it's you or something else, that'll be pulling on the hitch, attached to the sling down here. You don't want to attach your load to the carabiner, because any load on the carabiner actually releases the hitch. So the carabiner is convenient for, say, if you're ascending the rope, you can slide the hitch up, but then when you go to weight the hitch, you want your connection point to be below it on that extra length of sling or cord. So, and this is great. It works better than some hitches on like snowy or frozen rope. That's pretty much all there is to it. Oh, one thing to keep in mind, I should say, is this only really works best in one direction. So whatever direction this last bit of sling or cord is pointing towards, that's the direction of force that it will best work with. So right now I kind of have it configured for being able to ascend or descend. I wouldn't be applying like an upward force. I would want to wrap it up from the bottom up, so this was pulling upwards. Say if you wanted to use it for the pulling point on a Z-rig or something like that. So just keep that in mind. Another friction hitch you can tie is called the Klemheist. And this can be tied either with cord or with webbing or a sling. For this one, like the Bachmann, I do prefer to use a pre-sewn sling as well. And also like the Bachmann, this one is directional. Depending on how you tie it, it will either be good for an upward pull or a downward pull. So when you go to tie it, again, just keep the stitched or tied portion of the sling near the end, away from where you'll be tying it. We're gonna start off essentially like the Autoblock. We're gonna make some spiral wraps. And if I want this to hold a downward pulling force, I'm gonna wrap from the bottom up. And if you wanna hold an upward pulling force, you do the opposite. So once I know I have enough wraps to create the friction I need, I'm gonna end it so that there's a little bit of a loop left at the top. Then I'm going to take the rest of the sling, feed it through that loop, and then pull back down. And that's the Klemheist. And so again, this holds well right now in a downward pulling direction. I can slide this up, I can slide this down, but whenever you go to weight it, make sure you're weighting it just like the Bachmann from this lower loop. So this is great for ascending or descending a rope. It's great for using in a pulley system. It pretty much great for anything you really need it. It will release under tension better than a Prusik, but not as easily as the Autoblock. There you have it. The last friction hitch I want to show you is called the VT Prusik, and VT is short for Valdotane Tress. And
Just like when I was showing you the Autoblock for the VT Prusik, I have another specific product. And this product itself is actually called the VT Prusik, made by Blue Water. Hollow block made by Sterling. It is hollow on the inside, and it's made out of a high melting temperature rated material. But instead of it being a closed loop, it's a single length with two eyes on both ends. And to tie the VT Prusik, maybe I can zoom in a little so you can see this. It's a little complicated, but maybe like that. So you want to start off near the middle of the cord. Have it offset slightly depending on how many wraps you think you'll need. And with the longer end, make usually 3 or 4 upward wraps. You might have to give yourself more slack as you do it. Cool. There we go. And once you have those wraps, double check that these eyes want to hang down at the same length. And then what you'll do is you'll bring both these ends down and do what's called a French braid. So on your way down, you're going to crisscross these two strands against each other, and you're going to alternate which one overlaps the other. And get it as tight as you can, then bring these two eyes together. And clip them together with a carabiner. And that's the VT Prusik. And if you don't have this specific product, you can tie this with a length of cord. You just have to tie a loop in each end. You can accomplish the same thing. And this is great because no matter how much weight it's pretty much pulling, you can pretty easily release it just by pulling down on it from the top. So this works great for a bunch of stuff just for that reason. It's great as a third hand for rappelling. If you do want to have your third hand mounted above your blade of ice on the main line, it's great as a progress capture device in a pulley system because you don't need a releasable hitch. Let's say if you have to lower someone back down while they're in the pulley system, this can do that on its own. It's great for passing knots, either again through a pulley system, or if you're just raising someone up or lowering someone, this is great for passing knots. It's great for ascending a rope, descending it. Like the Bachmann and the Klemheist, it is directional. So the way it's configured right now, it's meant for a downward pulling force. You'd simply tie it upside down if you want to be able to haul something upward with it. So, and the reason I'm showing you all these different friction hitches is because depending on the situation you're in and what gear you're carrying, you might only be able to tie one or two of these. So having all these in the back of your head will have you better prepared should the situation arise. So keep that in mind. Another useful hitch is called the Garda Hitch. And what's great about it is that it performs like a progress capture device. So it lets you pull rope through it in one direction, and if rope tries to pull through it from the other direction, it'll stop on its own. And really, all you need other than the rope you're working with are two carabiners. And actually, for the most part, you want these to be non-locking carabiners. Because you'll see in a second, but usually with a locking carabiners, the bulky gate on a locking carabiner can prevent the Garda hitch from working. So what you do is you take your rope. I'm going to take the tail end, clip it through both carabiners. Right now this is the tail end side, this is the load end side. Take the tail strand, bring it underneath those carabiners and around, and clip it into just the carabiner on the load side so that it pops out in between those two non-locking carabiners. So now I can pull rope through on the tail side, but if I pull up or pull down on the load side, it cinches up. And it doesn't really show it now because I have these two anchored into a carabiner, but say I had these two non-lockers clipped into like a sling. These gates can sometimes try to get really close to each other, and if a gap is allowed to be present there, sometimes the hitch won't work. So just keep that in mind, and that's why you typically use this with non-locking carabiners. So this is great because you can also use this to ascend a rope. And how you can do that is if you clip these two non-lockers to the belay loop on your harness, and then rig your rope that you'll be ascending through the Garda hitch so that you can pull slack through it downwards, but then when you sit down on it and weight it, it'll hold for you. But you want to be careful because since these are non-lockers, there is a chance they can come unclipped. So the other strand that you have for your leg loop, you'll want to click like an additional runner to that and have that girth hitched or clipped with a locking carabiner to your belay loop as well as a redundant component. So yeah, there you go. The last hitch I want to go over is called the Munter hitch or Munter hitch. And this hitch is great because it can essentially turn a carabiner into a belay device or a rappel device. And it's actually pretty straightforward to tie. So what I do is you want to keep in mind what hand you like to use for your brake strand hand. I like to use my right hand. So here's my right hand. I make a loop in such a way that the brake strand ends up below the main line of rope and the loop is popping off to the left. And then I bring that brake strand over to the belly of the loop, grab it, and the way my hand is grabbed around those two strands, that's the same way the carabiner will clip into the hitch. So I'll bring it over. Clip it in. And it looks just like that. Can zoom in a little for you guys. And you'll notice that I have the brake strand so that it's sliding along the spine of the carabiner. You want to make sure you do that, say if you're rappelling, because if the brake strand is resting against the gate of the carabiner, and especially if it's a screw gate carabiner, the motion of the brake strand moving can actually unlock your carabiner and then potentially come undone. So keep an eye on that. So, you know, I can let rope out to lower down, and you'll see that if I go to maybe take slack in, like if I'm belaying someone while they're coming up, the hitch actually flips through the carabiner and reverses itself. So the strand was the brake strand, but now it's acting as the load line. So this is one way you can double check that you tied this correctly, is just alternate pulling on it in different directions. And if it flips through, then you know you properly tied the munter. One useful thing that a munter can also be used for, other than for lowering or belaying, is to use it as a load release hitch, which means you kind of set this up kind of upstream or closer to the anchor, you know, or rather between the anchor and like a pulley system, because some of the progress capture features of certain pulley system setups can't be released under tension. So you can set up a munter between that progress capture device and the anchor. So if you do have to lower someone, say you're hauling them up with a Z-rig and their harness gets caught on a rock or a branch, you know, if you're just using a Prusik as a progress capture, you won't be able to release that Prusik, that weight. So having a pre-rigged munter above that pulley system can allow you to lower your patient back down, get them off that snag, and then you can continue to haul them back up. So if you do want to use a munter in that way, you'll have to tie it off so that it doesn't let rope out when you don't want it to. And to do that, you're going to have to tie what's called a mule hitch. And to do that, I'm going to bring my brake strand and keep it parallel with the main line of rope. But I'm going to flip it back up so that it becomes perpendicular across the main load, and that'll create a loop. And then I'm going to bring that brake strand around behind the hitch and poke a bite through that loop I just made, cinch it up. You can see I'm getting pretty close to my tail, but get that nice and tight. And I'm gonna pull enough slack through to make this bite bigger that I can now tie an overhand on a bite around the main line of rope as well. So I've got my munter, got my mule hitch, and an overhand. And that's a pretty common setup you'll see in rope rescue systems. So if I need to release the load on the munter, I undo that overhand. And let's say I didn't have enough tail to tie that overhand to begin with. I could just take an extra locking carabiner, clip it through that loop and the main line of rope. And that'll work too if you don't have enough rope to tie that overhand. But when you're ready to release your load, before you completely pull that bite and undo the mule hitch, just get a good grip on the tail, and you're gonna release it by pulling with a good deal of force, but in a smooth way, pull downward and keep it in line with the load strand, because that will keep the munter hitch in the brake position once that mule hitch has been pulled apart. So just be ready to hold the load once you pull that mule hitch apart. So I'm just going to pull nice and smooth in a downward motion. Hear it pop loose. Now if I want to, I can ease up and lower my patient until they're clear of that snag. That's a nice, useful feature of the Munter. Another cool feature is you can kind of turn the Munter into a progress capture device of its own. So let's say I have it configured to where I can be pulling someone up. So this is the load line, or the line that's going to, say, a person that I'm belaying. If I clip kind of the lower loop that's within the Munter to that strand that's going down to my climber or patroller who's ascending a steep pitch, I can keep pulling rope through to let them come up, but if they fall or they need to take a break, the way this carabiner is clipped into that hitch, it keeps the Munter from being able to flip through the carabiner like I showed you when I initially tied it, and that effectively turns it into a progress catch. So if they start climbing up again, I can go back to belaying them. If they fall, it'll keep it from flipping through. It's nice to use this with a locking carabiner, though, just because that carabiner can move around so much. It's not the smoothest thing, but it's nice in a jiffy if you need it. And one thing to keep in mind is that it's pretty hard, if not impossible, to undo this additional carabiner when there's a load on it. So if you do need to lower your person back down, you can try to have them unweight the rope really quick and just get that carabiner out of there, and then you can go back to a regular Munter hitch. The last thing I want to show you with the Munter is that if there isn't enough friction, say you're using a thinner line, or maybe you're trying to rappel with two people, or you're trying to lower down a loaded toboggan, you can tie what's called a super Munter or a monster Munter, which is essentially two Munters kind of within each other. And to do that, show you again. So this will be my brake hand, and because you want to end up, at least for me, with a right hand brake strand, that means I actually have to tie a left hand Munter first. So to do that, I have my tail off on the left side, I have my main line of rope, and I created a loop just like I did earlier. Maybe I can come over here. But now I'm going to bring that tail up and around my hand, over my hand. I'm gonna swap hands so I can actually do this. It's kind of hard to see. And then back up again. So I have these three strands in front of my hand, and how my hand is holding those three strands is how the carabiner is going to get clipped into the super Munter. Clip that in, and immediately you'll see that there's a lot more friction. It takes a lot more force to pull that through. And again, try to have that brake strand along the spine of the carabiner, not the gate. But if I did try to belay someone with this and pull on the tail, you'll see it still inverts the Munter hitch like earlier. And it actually kind of inverts twice because there's two different Munter hitches within there. It's So it does still invert like the original one. There's just a lot more friction and it takes a little more force to get it to invert. One thing I didn't mention yet is that the single Munter hitch puts twists in the rope, kind of like a figure eight descent device. But in the Monster Munter or Super Munter, because there's two Munters within it, there's a left-hand Munter and a right-hand Munter, those twists, for the most part, get canceled out. So that's convenient if you do end up using this. Okay, just keep that in mind.